the third unit, we are going to discuss about software concepts. So here we just get to know what is a software, what is a program, and what is an instruction. So software can be, it is a collection of programs, and program can be, it is a collection of an instructions, and instruction can be an individual command given by the user. And when it comes to the types of softwares, we have two types of softwares. One is system software, another one is application software. System software that works with the hardware components of the system, whereas application software can be used to develop ready-made applications, right? So operating system is one of the best system software program that we have. And when it comes to operating system, it is an interface between user and computer, right? As I told you now, operating system is a system program, system software that consisting of collection of programs. What kind of programs that it consists of means it consisting of compilers, interpreters, linkers, loaders, right? Utility software, all such programs are included in this system software. And when it comes to the functions of operating system, it can be used to perform different tasks that includes file sharing, then resource sharing, all such things can be done by input-output management, processor management, all these things are done by the operating system. And we have two types of operating systems. One is single-user operating system and one is multi-user operating system. As the name indicates, system, single-user operating system, it works with the individual user and what at once one command or one program can be executed. And Microsoft Disk operating system is a best example for single-user operating system. And when it comes to multi-user operating system, multiple users can work with this particular type of operating system and multiple programs or multiple type of applications can be executed simultaneously. And Unix is one of the best example for multi-user operating system. And in between, we have one more important operating system called as Windows. So Windows is not a multi-user operating system. It is a multitasking or multi-programming operating system. So in case of Windows, it can be defined as it is a single-user operating system only, but we can perform multiple tasks with respect to this single-user operating system, Windows. Okay. So now, once again, there is a difference between single-user operating system and multi-user operating system. And I can tell you one more type of operating system that includes character user interface and graphical user interface. So when it comes to character user interface, for every task, we are going to type a command or execute a command for performing that task. So in this chapter, we just learn about what is an operating system, what are the types of operating system, what are the functions of operating system. All such things can be learned. Along with that one, system software and application software, all both the things we discuss in this particular chapter. So here is the base things to learn about the computer software and program concepts in this chapter. Okay, so here is the diagrammatic representation that gives you the complete picture about this particular chapter, right? So moving to the next one, right? We have the next one, that is problem solving techniques. So everywhere there is a problem, and for every problem we'll get a solution. And mathematics give you different types of solution, physics give you different types of solution for a problem, accounting technology will give you different types of solution for a given problem, and at the same time we have our computer science that gives you solution in different ways. Okay, so when a problem is given, what is the problem, whether it is a useful problem to solve or not. That means when we are going to develop an application for a given problem, right? So how we are going to develop an application and who will be a profitable person with respect to that particular application development, right? So what is a problem, how to solve it, what are the steps involved in problem solving, right? All these things we are going to discuss in problem solving techniques. So first we just understand what is a computer and what is the components of the computer. Then how we are going to represent data in the computer, that also we have learned in second unit. And then what is a program, what is a software, what is the environment that we use, that we have learned in the previous chapter. And here we are going to solve a problem, right? Then before solving a problem, what is the problem and what are the different steps involved in solving a particular problem is discussed in this particular chapter. So here is the diagrammatic representation, right? So a programming problem consisting of solution of the programming problem consisting of different steps that includes identification of the problem, analysis, then design, then coding, testing and debugging, and then maintenance and documentation. So these steps are going to be involved in this particular chapter, right? So problem solving techniques we are going to learn here, and once we learn the problem solving techniques, then we are going to start with the actual programming. So when it comes to the programming concepts, in this particular 11th standard, we are going to learn a programming language called as C++, right? So C++ is an object-oriented programming language, right? So in this is the programming language that we are using to solve the problem that is given, right? So therefore, we have to learn all the programming concepts in this particular chapter, right? So programming language consisting of different rules, different syntaxes, and different tokens, all such things will be there. And before that, what kind of programming language is C++, right? What are the features, what are the advantages, disadvantages of this C++, and how the language C++ is derived, and what are the base languages to learn C++ to be learned. All such things are discussed in this chapter, right? So C++, it is a object-oriented programming language, and what are the tokens that are there in C++ language, that is variable, identifier, right, constant, data type, keywords, and operators. All are the tokens that we learn with respect to C++. And before that, what is the character set that can be used in C++ language? That means what are the characters that can be used here, and what is a comment statement in C++ language? Okay, all such things are learnt in the basic introduction chapter of C++ programming language. And then moving to the next one, as I told you, the tokens. So tokens are nothing but the elements of the programming language are called as tokens. And as I told you, there are 6 tokens we are going to discuss here. That is variable. So variables are used to store the values. Identifiers. Identifiers are names of the variables. Then constants, values that are remained unchanged throughout the program, they are called as constants. Then keywords are special words. Then operators are nothing but it is used to perform operation. It is a symbol that is used to perform different operations. And here we are going to see different types of constants, different types of keywords, different types of operators, a very rich set of operators that we are going to discuss in this particular C++ programming language. So all such classifications and types and their usage in our programming language are going to be discussed in this tokens of C++, right? So operators, as I told you, there is a rich set of operators in C++ that consisting of unary operator, binary operator, and ternary operator. So unary operator works with one operand, binary operator works with two operands, and ternary operator works with 3 operands.
Sir, highlighter source code, sir, I zoom on.
Okay.
Same answer, sir, system. Yeah.
Okay, sir. So when it comes to unary operators, it works only with the one operand. Okay, so these are the different unary operators. Logical NOT, bitwise complement, right? Unary minus, increment, decrement, all such operators comes as unary operators. And when it comes to binary operator, we have a variety of binary operators that includes arithmetic operators, relational operators, logical operators, then increment and decrement operators, bitwise operators, okay? So all are different, combined operator, special operator, assignment operator, that is equals to is an assignment operator. All these operators are called as binary operators. We have 8 variety of binary operators that we have in C++. And finally, a ternary operator which involves three operands is called as a conditional operator. The symbol for conditional operator is question mark and colon is the conditional operator that we have. And these are the basic operators that we use in our C++ programming language. Along with that one, we have different types of operators that includes member accessing operator, dot operator we call it as, scope resolution operator, double colon is called as scope resolution operator, which is a very important operator in C++ programming language. And here we learned all these operator types. Okay, so moving to the next one, here we discuss about different programming execution methods, right? So normally when you write a program, right, the program is executed in a sequential manner. Apart from sequential manner, what are the different types of executions? So conditional execution and loop execution or iterative execution are the two other types of programming execution techniques. When this comes to the execution types of execution, we are going to discuss about different control structures that consisting of conditional control statements, iterative statements and unconditional control statements. So that means control is going to transfer from one line to another line based on these three criterias. Number one, conditionally we send the control from one line of statement to another line of statement. Here we are going to discuss about if statements, different types of if statements. So simple if else, then nested if, then else if ladder, then switch statement. So these are the different conditional control statements that we discuss here. And go to is one unconditional control statement that we have. Without checking any condition, we are going to send the control from one line of statement to another line of statements. And when it comes to iterative statement, so this is conditional control statement and this is unconditional control statement. When it comes to iterative statements, we have different types of looping statements, that is iterative statements. Number one is while loop, number two is do while loop, and number three is for loop. So three types of looping statements that we are going to learn here, which will ever help in programming languages. So not only in C++ programming language, if you go to any programming language, these control structures will be available. And only difference between this particular programming language and other languages are, maybe it is different with syntax with respect to. Okay, so one programming language has its own syntax. So therefore, according to syntax, it is going to work, right? So these are the control structures that we are going to learn in C++ programming language. And after control structures, we are going to discuss about the concept of arrays. So what exactly is an array? So array can be, it is a collection of similar data items. When we want to declare collection of similar data items for a program, instead of declaring them individually, we are going to declare it as an array. So the array concepts are learnt in this particular chapter. So what is an array? What is the need of an array? And what are the different types of an arrays we have? And how to declare an array? How to initialize an array? How to access, that means how to read an array elements, and how to display the elements of the array are going to be discussed here. Along with that one, we are going to discuss different programs with respect to one-dimensional array, two-dimensional array. Okay, so these things are going to be covered in this particular chapter called as arrays. So a very important chapter. Once again, array concepts are available in all the programming languages. Okay, so this we are going to discuss the chapter called as arrays here. And moving to the next one, the most important concept of any programming language is called as functions. So function, it can be called as a subprogram. So subprograms can be divided into different subprograms based on the programming languages. So functions, procedures, methods, we call it with different names. Here in C++, we are using the name called as functions, and we have two types of functions. That is library function and user-defined functions. So what is a library function? What are the different library functions that we use in our programming language? And what are the different header files that we use to include to our C++ program is discussed in library functions. And moving to the next one, the second type of function called as user defined function. So what is a user defined function? That means defined by the user, therefore it is called as a user defined function. And what is the syntax of a user defined function? What are the different components used in user defined function? And moving to the next one, we have different categories of functions. So what are the different categories of functions and how the functionality for each category function is discussed in user defined function? Along with that one, what are the different function calling methods that we have? Okay, so all these things are discussed in this particular chapter. And different storage classes. So storage classes is a concept that gives you the information about the variable and the type of the variables and the scope of the variables and how much memory each variable occupies, right? All such things are discussed in storage classes, and this is also a concept related to functions chapter only, right? So therefore, all this, what is a user defined function, components of user defined function, categories of functions, function calling methods, then storage classes, all these things are discussed in the most important chapter called as functions, right? So moving to the next one, arrays is one type of data type, and basic data types we have seen. And here is the first time we are going to discuss a user defined data type. We call that user defined data type as structure. So what is a structure? Why we need a concept of structure here? And afterwards, what, how to declare a structure and what a structure contains and why to declare structure in a program. After that, how to declare structure variables, right? All such things are discussed in this chapter. And what components can be used in a structure? Okay, so how the basic types are used inside a structure and how to use the structure members after the program, right? All such things are discussed in this chapter called as structures. And with this, we conclude the concept of C++ programming language. And afterwards, we will be having some general programming concepts that includes Microsoft Access. So Microsoft Access, it is a system, so, I mean application software. We are going to learn. So this is a office tool that is provided by the Microsoft company. And in this particular year, see here I have listed some of the Microsoft application tools. One is Microsoft Word, one is Microsoft PowerPoint, number one, number three is Microsoft Excel, and the last one is Access. So Word is used to develop documents in a official or a personal environment. So therefore, Microsoft Word is one document tool that we have. And Excel, it is a tabular representation tool that is used to analyze data. A large volume of data can be analyzed here. And when it comes to PowerPoint, it is a presentation tool. So how to present a particular thing can be designed with the help of this PowerPoint presentation. So this we are going to learn here. And finally, Microsoft Access, it is a database tool that is used to store the database. And when it comes to the first PUC, that is 11th standard computer science, we are going to learn about the concept of Microsoft Word and Microsoft PowerPoint. So here in 11th standard, we learn what is Word and how to, I mean, what are the different features and tools and techniques that are available with respect to Microsoft Word, that we are going to learn. And when it comes to PowerPoint, what is a PowerPoint, how to create a PowerPoint presentation, what are the different things that can be included to a PowerPoint presentation. These two things we are going to learn in this particular 11th standard. And Excel is used in 12th standard, that we are going to learn in 12th standard, right? So this is the extra tool that we are learning in 11th standard. And moving to the next one, and the last concept of 11th standard is web programming. So web programming is useful for designing a web page. So web page is basically, we call it as an online document which runs on a browser, right? So how to create a web page? For that, we have different web programming tools that we have. And here in this 11th standard, we are going to learn a HTML, stands for Hypertext Markup Language. So HTML is called as Hypertext Markup Language, the only markup language that we use to develop web pages, right? So what is a HTML? What is the structure of HTML program? And what are the elements of HTML program? That means we call them as tags in this case, right? So all these different types of tags we are going to use, and along with that one we are going to create different web pages. So with this we conclude the 11th standard syllabus of computer science. So here we have learned what is a computer and basics of the computer. After that, what are the different types of data representation, right? And after that, what is a program and what are the different programming concepts, that we also learned here. Then moving to the next one, we have learned what are the different problem solving techniques or methods that we have and what are the steps involved in problem solving is discussed here. And then comes to the programming language called as C++. It is an object oriented programming language. So we learned completely about the C++ programming language, and after that we have learned the basic tools that we call it as MS Office. So MS Office tools few we are learning here, and then we are learning the concept of web programming, which is very useful for you people. Okay, so this comprises the syllabus of 11th standard that we are going to learn here. Okay, so why we are learning computer, we just have discussed about this, right? So everywhere in our daily life and our human life, computer is the main tool that we are using, or a device that we are using. Every subject, it is learned through the computer science only. Now let me tell you why Asmat Guru. So Asmat Guru will provide you a beautiful platform for learning computer science. Okay, so Asmat Guru, it is an online platform that can learn, and when you are going through this, if you find any doubts, you can just mail me so that you can clarify your doubts. Or if you want to clarify your doubts directly, we can have a session to clarify your doubts so that you can understand in a better manner. For that reason also, I suggest you people to go for Asmat Guru, where you will not find such kind of environment or such kind of facilities in other places. Therefore, I suggest you people to go for Asmat Guru, right? So you can learn and you can go with the videos or view with the videos any number of times without any problem. You can learn the things here in a cleaner and better understanding manner. So I suggest you people to go for Asmat Guru, and you can clarify your doubts through mails, or a live interaction session also can be held so that you can clarify your doubts in a live manner only, right? So these are some of the advantages of Asmat Guru. And why to learn computer science in Asmat Guru? As I told you, there are many application areas where the computers are used, right? So computer science is used in every field, not only a specific computer science learning field or anywhere. So if you go to physical science, if you go to biological science, if you go to research, if you go to commerce and management, a beautiful website for online business can be developed, whatnot. Everywhere, every application area includes computer science. So as soon as we get up, we just look into the mobile. Mobile is also an electronic device, and whatever we are learning can be learned through mobile also. Therefore, mobile also consisting of an electronic device only. And see how we are using mobile. In the similar manner, we use computer science or computer device in our daily life for each and every thing what we do. Okay, so therefore it is very essential to learn the language called as computer science, right? And it is the base science at this point of time. See, normally one language can be told that it is the base language for learning other things, or one type of science can be told to learn other types of sciences. Here, computer is one thing that can be useful to learn all technologies, all subjects, and all technologies can be learned through this computer science. So once you learn computer science, you will be able to learn anything within your hand, right? So computer, internet technology will provide you the information about each and every subject what you wanted to learn in your life. So for that reason, first you have to learn computer science. So this is the best time to learn computer science, and you just make use of this opportunity to learn computer so that you can teach the people to learn computer science. If you have elders in your home, you just can make them to learn how to send a mail, how to chat with the people who are there in abroad or somewhere like that, and you can make them to learn how to do online business, or you can make them to work with the computer by teaching them the simple basics of the computer. If it is to younger generation, you people learn enormous technologies at this point of time. So technology is going across the limits, and off the box, you can learn anything by learning this computer. Okay, so for that reason, for learning any subject, you need to learn computer science so that you can learn any other subjects also. So this is the best time to learn, and this is the best platform to learn computer science. Choose Asmat Guru and make your life beautiful, technical full, and a beautiful life can be learned from this particular platform. Hope you are learning here from this one, and have a happy learning. Asmat Guru Bhyo Namaha.